Hello, I'm Pastor Don Smith from the Waynesfield Baptist Church in Waynesfield, Ohio. We're located at 512 North Westminster Street in Waynesfield. Our worship times are at 8:30 a.m. with Sunday school at 9:30 for all ages, and we worship again at 10:30 a.m. You can find us on YouTube and Facebook, and on Wednesdays mornings you can find our devotional on both of those, YouTube and Facebook. Come and join us, and we'll be glad to see you.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. From sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransom soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
This is a Wednesday devotional for the Waynesfield Baptist Church. My name's Robert Waitman. I am a local Baptist minister here, and I help do these devotions. I pray they'll be a blessing to you. Tonight, or today, whatever time you listen to this, we are going to be talking about experiencing God's fullness. I pray that God can help me to deliver the thoughts I've had on this. I want to turn to Ephesians chapter 3. I want to read verses 14 through 21. For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Jesus Christ throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Lord, I pray in these first few moments here I might be able to lay this groundwork, Lord. Please give me clarity of thought and words and thoughts that I've had, Lord, and just the things that you would have to come out of this. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. As I was thinking about it, I'm going to turn to another passage in a little bit, and that will be in Psalm 36. There's a few verses there. But I was thinking about the fullness of God and how God, being the immense person that he is, he's omnipotent, he's omniscient, he's omnipresent, he's full of grace, he's full of mercy, he's full of truth. There's so many good character qualities about God that it's almost impossible for me to put into words what I'm trying to think and say to you tonight. But it's the fullness of God. And the key thought that I was thinking about here that I was always been thinking about all my life maybe and try to find some explanation is it in verse 18, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. And I always wondered at that and I said, what is Paul kind of trying to talk about? These sound like dimensions for a building. This sounds like something when you go to buy a house or a piece of land, some kind of a building or acreage. You want to know the dimensions of it. And how does that work into the Christian life that you might be filled with all the fullness of God? And this I can say this much. It proceeds from the love of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. In this passage it says we should be rooted and grounded in love. In verse 19 it says to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. God's fullness proceeds from the love of Christ. Not that we loved him, but that he loved us and gave his son to be the propitiation for our sins. It has to be comprehended by faith. Our fullness and the love of Christ that we have that fullness by is comprehended by faith. It is also known in verse 19, it's known by the fellowship of the Trinity. If you look in this passage, you see in verse 16 that he's strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. You see God mentioned in the passage. We're supposed to be filled with all the fullness of God in verse 19. And of course, Christ is named many times here. I don't know how anyone could not believe in the Trinity. We baptize in the name of the Father and the Son, the Holy Ghost. And I'm not here tonight to speak on the Trinity, but I just want to tell you, that's the fullness of God, is to be strengthened in the inner man to know a Savior that's in heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is sent by his Father to this world to redeem this wicked world so that we might have fellowship with our Father through the Lord Jesus Christ by fellowship in our spirit with him. That's the complete fullness. If we could just get that concept and not walk in the flesh, but walk in the Spirit, we might be able to come to places and enjoyment in our life where we experience the fullness of God. That we might know the breadth, the length, the depth, the height, the immense qualities of the character of God. I believe that's what this is leading us into as we go back to Psalms here in a few minutes. But we need to explore and the intimate and infinite character of God. We are enriched in God's glory by the Spirit's filling. We understand the glory of God because of the things that the Spirit of truth teaches us. And we are brought from glory unto glory. There's been times in your experience and in my experience when we have found some attribute of God that has been made known unto us in our daily life. We need to explore this intimacy with God. The breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. God's wisdom, it says, has dimensions. I want to read this before, on your way back to Psalms 36, I want to stop at Job 11, the book previous to it, in Job 11, and it says here in verse 7, canst thou, by searching, find out God? Canst thou find out the Almighty unto perfection? It is as high as heaven. What canst thou do deeper than hell? What canst thou know? The measure thereof is longer than the earth and broader than the sea. The wisdom of God, the knowledge of God, in our own finite minds has such immense dimensions, higher than heaven, deeper than hell. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions. That's quite a distance. As I've heard the old preacher say, you know, there, you can go north and eventually you'll reach the North Pole and then you'll start heading south. But you know, when you talk about east and west, you can just keep going east and east and east and you never come to west. Or you can go west and west and west and you never come to east. It's interesting that God said, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions. I want to talk about back here in the book of Psalms and verse 36. I was reading this the other day and it just struck me that this passage fits in with what we're talking about out of Ephesians 3. To know the fullness of God, to know his character, to know his dealings, his perfections, his heart, his great love for us, wherewith he hath loved us in Christ. In Psalm 36 and verse 5, the Bible says, thy mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens. That's a long way off. You know, the Bible talks about three heavens, the third heaven. We have the heaven around that we can see here, our firmament we live in. You have the stars, that's the second heaven. And then you have the third heaven in the sides of north where God dwelleth. His mercy is in the heavens. Can you measure heaven? Does anybody know how large the infinite expanse of heaven and eternity is? No one does. But that's the only way that David could say how large and immense God's mercy is. Mercy is not receiving our punishment or sentence through the compassionate act of a kind, just God. These are my observations. These are my words. I didn't really get these out of the dictionary, but I studied those concepts. Mercy rejoices against judgment. James 2:13. I deserve to go to hell for my sin. I've done enough things since I got saved to merit hell. But God, through his mercy, saved me, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. It says in Lamentations 3, verses 22 and 23, that his mercies are new every morning. Every day, there's new mercy. There's a never-ending supply of mercy. I don't know about you, but there's a lot of times I've got myself in a fix and I've had to say to God, boy, God, I need some mercy today. Boy, Lord, if you don't be merciful, I'm going to fall flat on my face and I'm going to make a mess out of this. I just pray that you be merciful to me. I don't deserve the mercy, but God, I know that you want to give it to me because I believe what the Bible says about you being a merciful God. Also, the Bible talks about here in this passage, in verse 5, not only is his mercy in the heavens, it says, thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. How many clouds are there in the earth at any given time? We can kind of measure and know how big a thunderhead is or these little fluffy clouds, but who could count all the distance of all the clouds at any given time? No one could. But David, just looking out and seeing the atmosphere around him, he said, God, thy faithfulness reacheth unto the clouds. God is faithful. Faithfulness is the quality of doing what has been promised to another, regardless of circumstances or outcome on their behalf. It's fidelity in covenant relationship. You know, it says in the book of Hebrews that Jesus is found to be a merciful and faithful high priest. He was tempted in all points, like as we are, and yet without sin. He is faithful that promised. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all righteousness. One of the main things that makes God different than most of us on earth, we want to try to be like that, and we can be by the Spirit of God. We can portray that character of God in some small measure. But God is faithful. He has a covenant with us. He says, I'll never leave thee. I'll never forsake thee. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. God made that promise to every believer that I'm saved because of his faithfulness, not because of mine. If I could be faithful enough to merit my own salvation, I wouldn't need God. I'd be saved by my own works, my own goodness. I can't do that. No one can. But Jesus Christ came to be the substitute for us, to be faithful in all things, someone that God could trust in, someone that we can trust in and continue to trust in. Righteousness is also mentioned here in verse 6 of Psalm 36. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains. Are you getting this about the breadth, the length, the height? These huge dimensions that we read about back in Ephesians, David is doing something similar. He's likening the great character and the great intimacy of fellowship that God has with us, the experiences we have, the recognitions we have of God's dealing with us, unto things that are almost practically immeasurable by mankind. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains. I can't even count all the great mountains. I would almost dare someone to be able to count all the mountains just in West Virginia or Pennsylvania. So many. Or in the Rockies. Think about all the mountains on the earth and the great distances and heights and territories that cover, the ones under the sea even. Thy righteousness is like the great mountains. Righteousness is being just, correct, doing the right thing in every thought and deed, in all dealings and judgments. In Acts 17 and verse 31, I'd like to read this verse to you. Acts 17 and 31. In Paul's message on Mars Hill, he said this to that great city. The times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men, and that he hath raised him from the dead. God's righteousness is proven in Christ. Our assurance of salvation is hinged upon the very fact of Christ's resurrection. If Jesus had not been just, if he had not been faithful, if he could not have been a merciful and faithful high priest, then God would not have raised him from the dead. But his resurrection is assurance for us. It is God's seal of approval. When they found the stone rolled away and the angel said, he's not here, it was assurance that he could be trusted, that God accepted him, and that we could accept Christ, and that we would be accepted of God in the Beloved, in the person of Christ. And in Romans 3 is a great passage. I won't read all that, but you should read it for yourself. Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 26, the word God's righteousness shows up many, many times in that passage. And it is proclaimed in the gospel of Christ. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. I believe that shows up in Romans chapter 10. But nonetheless, God's righteousness is revealed in Christ. God's righteousness is proclaimed through the gospel of Christ. That's how you experience God. That's how you come across all these qualities of God, is in relationship with him. Yielding to the Spirit of God. The Spirit is truth. He will show you things to come. He'll bring to remembrance all the things that Jesus said in the New Testament as you read them and bring them to light and in your life. You can experience the fullness of God. There's no reason we can't. If Paul said we could, then we can. Also, it says in this passage, Psalm 36, and the last part of verse 6 is, thy judgments are a great deep. We talked about, so far, the heavens, the clouds, the mountains, now the great deep. That's the ocean. Thy judgments are a great deep, O Lord. Judgments are actions and deeds declared as righteous by a just God. Some of those judgments, and usually find this word in the Old Testament, along with the other words you might find coupled with it, are statutes, commandments, and laws. Some of them give direction from the negative. Thou shalt not. Remember the first time you read in Exodus the giving of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not bear false witness, and on and on. Some of them are on the negative. They tell you what you shouldn't do. Want to keep you out of trouble, keep you away from sin, keep you from transgressing against God and your brother. Most of them are affirmative in their contents, in their context. In Romans 10:5, Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth those things shall live by them. The judgments, the statutes, the precepts, the laws, the commandments. I can't even keep them all, but I know they're good. The law is just and holy and good. But the problem was we couldn't keep it. Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone believeth. But God always has done the right thing. And when God puts forth his word, it's always right. We may not ever understand all the depths and the heights and the breadth and the length of it. But we know that however God intended it in the Old Testament times, when we want ponder upon it, Paul said, now we look through a glass darkly, but then face to face. I don't know everything that I'll know when I get to heaven. I'm growing in grace and knowledge. You should be growing in grace and knowledge. You should be desiring the sincere milk of the word that you might grow thereby and not stay a babe in Christ. We should grow up in faith. We should grow into a perfect man as much as we can. But God's judgments are like a great deep. Who can tell how deep the deepest parts of the ocean are? No man can go down and explore those depths of the ocean. The great pressures there, we can't even build something reliable for a man to go down to the bottom of the ocean in the deepest parts. And yet God's judgments, the truth of his living word is just like that. And then there's loving kindness. This passage says, Psalm 36, verse 7, how excellent is thy loving kindness, O God, therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. They shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house, and thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. Loving kindness, actions of God, especially with his children of the household of faith, in covenant relationship, which actions exude an unfathomable amount of kindness, unfailing love, and good favor. Titus 3:4, but after that the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. Loving kindness. Ephesians 2, verse 4 says that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. All these great attributes and dealings of God with his children, with mankind, the availability to fellowship with God in fullness. He's not a God that's afar off. That's what Paul spoke on Mars Hill. He said, you've set up these idols, you've set up this plaque here, it says, to the unknown God. He's not far off. You can know him by faith. You can know him, if you're born again, you can know him in the inner man. You can fellowship with him in the Spirit, and you can experience this fullness, this unfathomable, even almost what I want to say, it's hard for me to explain the thought as I've tried in a weak way to show you that there's more that can be in your Christian life than just say, yeah, I got saved 20 years ago and praise God, that was it. You can grow in grace and knowledge as a Christian. You can make yourself available, and God will teach you and show you. If you read a lot of these Psalms that David wrote, he was in a lot of trouble sometimes. And that's how God revealed himself to him, in his mercies, in his loving kindnesses, in his faithfulness, in his righteousness. David knew that if he did the right thing, that God would bless him, God would preserve him, God would deliver him from his enemies. He did it over and over and over again. But he also knew that he had a heavenly Father. If he did the wrong thing, God would chasten him and correct him as a father doth his son. And he experienced that also. He knew that God's judgments were true. And he broke some of those judgments, and God corrected him for it. But I want to say this in closing, that God preserves his creation. It says there in Psalm 36 and verse 6, O Lord, thou preservest man and beast. When it says that God has us under his wings, how immense are the wings of the grace of God and the mercy of God and the loving kindness of God and the righteousness of Christ. How many millions upon millions over the ages of Israel in the Old Testament and the church in the New Testament times are trusting under the shadow of God's wings. How immense is that? How immense is the power and the greatness of the preservation of God? I'm sealed unto the day of redemption by the Holy Spirit of promise. He's excellent. There's no faults in his loving kindness. And we are abundantly satisfied from the fatness of God's house, drinking from the rivers of God's pleasures. What a river! I can't even explain. You know, he that believeth on me, Jesus said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. We can be thirsty. This world is a dry place. But in Jesus and through the Spirit of God, we can be satisfied over and over again because of the fullness of God. Let's pray, and I'd like to sing a song. Lord, I pray that you'd bless this message tonight. I pray, Lord, you'd help someone out there who's thirsting for something different than this world gives. Lord, all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, it's not of the Father, but it's of the world. Father, I just pray that you'd give them a thirst for heavenly things, for that close fellowship with you. God, I can't even, in words, even come close to describing what someone could experience over and over again as you reveal yourself to them and deal in their daily life and help them to grow. And then they look back on the years that they've spent with you. How great is our God? I pray and thank you tonight for this time, Lord, we spent in your word and in prayer and in fellowship. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to just sing a song that I love, and the song is called My Jesus, I Love Thee. I'll try my best.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say when the death dew lies cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with a glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. Amen. God bless you.